So, welcome all of you to the second session sponsored by the Carl Jasper Society of North America, that is to say, you. This session is entitled Structuralism After Kant. I take it that the after is meant both in the temporal and the logical senses, right? Subsequent chronologically, but also related to and inspired by in some sense that we will hear about structuralism after Kant. The first speaker to my left is Andrew Cutrofello from Loyola University in Chicago. He is professor at Loyola. He is the author of, I didn't count them up, looks like 6 books, as well as, I don't know, some numbers of dozens of essays on Shakespeare, interestingly, Kant, Nietzsche, Foucault, Quine, and Derrida, among others. His paper today is entitled, Was It For This? Brandom, Wordsworth, and the French Revolution.
Okay, thank you, Richard, and thank you. I'd like to thank Helmut and Pierre for organizing this session. All of you, of course, for being here. William Wordsworth began working on an autobiographical poem on a trip to Germany in October 1798. By December 1799, his 150-line fragment had grown into a 2-part poem of almost 1,000 lines. By May 1805, it was a 13-book poem of some 8,500 lines. And for the next 45 years, Wordsworth would tinker with it, leaving behind a 14-book version for posthumous publication under the title The Prelude. Luckily for us, and probably for him, Robert Brandom took slightly less time to complete A Spirit of Trust, a reading of Hegel's Phenomenology. When it finally appeared in print after nearly 4 decades of gestation, James Cohen could, with some understatement, call it long awaited. But there's another basis of comparison with The Prelude, one noted by Brandom himself. About halfway through writing his Hegel book, he made a passing remark about Wordsworth's poem, observing that it illustrated Hegel's thesis that, in Brandom's words, the way we understand and conceive what we are doing affects what we are, in fact, doing. We find a way forward by reconstruing the path that brought us to our present situation. And then in a note, Brandom adds, Wordsworth said that the child is the father of the man. But his prelude was more than just his account of how he started out and developed on his way to being who and getting where he is at the time of writing it. It is the greatest achievement of his maturity. That account of the roots of his self, his sensibility, and his work is his achieved self, sensibility, and work, end quote. Well, something similar could be said about the phenomenology of spirit. Its account of the roots of spirit's self, sensibility, and work is spirit's achieved self, sensibility, and work. The phenomenology and the prelude are structurally similar texts, as many commentators have pointed out. They both recount the process by which their authors came to be capable of writing them. Hegel represents a series of shapes of spirit that culminates in absolute knowing. Wordsworth depicts a series of spots of time that culminates in what might be called absolute imagining. Wordsworth's aim was to explain how he came to think of himself as a poet. Hegel's aim was to explain how spirit, the I that is we and the we that is I, came to understand itself as spirit. The Phenomenology was published in 1807. The 13-book prelude was put aside in 1805. Why it should suddenly have seemed important to a German philosopher and an English poet to tell their respective developmental stories is a question worth considering. It wasn't just idle curiosity. They both felt that in order to move forward with a new project, in Hegel's case, a system of science, in Wordsworth's case, a philosophical poem called The Recluse, or Views of Nature, Man, and Society, Richard talked a little bit about it yesterday, they had to tell a story about how they had come to find it necessary to tell that very story. Only by telling it could they find a way forward. Well, measured by this standard, Hegel may be said to have succeeded in a way that Wordsworth did not. After publishing The Phenomenology, Hegel did eventually write The Science of Logic, published in 1812, and The Encyclopedia of the Philosophical Sciences, 1817. But Wordsworth remained stuck, unable to make significant progress on The Recluse. Given the structural and motivational parallels between the Phenomenology and the Prelude, it's worth considering whether these different outcomes may have had something to do with the ways in which they executed their respective projects. Maybe Hegel would have faltered if instead of writing about the development of spirit, he had written about his childhood pastimes and residence at Tübingen. Maybe Wordsworth would have succeeded if instead of reminiscing about stolen boats and personal trips to France, he had focused on the causes and consequences of the French Revolution. But the problem with such counterfactuals is that they're barely counterfactuals at all. Even though Hegel didn't explicitly talk about his time at Tübingen, he had implicitly recounted the story of his own personal philosophical development. And likewise, Wordsworth didn't just write about his own experiences at Cambridge, London, and Paris. He had described shapes of spirit as well. Despite the different emphases of the new genres they invented, the dialectical narrative and the long autobiographical poem, the genres themselves don't explain why Wordsworth got stuck and Hegel didn't. What might help to explain this difference, apart, of course, from our contingent biographical circumstances, is how they changed their conceptions of their projects in midstream. When Wordsworth began writing about his childhood, he did not plan to discuss his time in France. Only after completing the two-part prelude did he realize that he couldn't explain his mature conception of his vocation without saying something about how he had responded to the French Revolution. Likewise, when Hegel began writing the Phenomenology, he didn't plan to discuss the history of spirit. As the first part of his system of science, the Phenomenology would only include chapters on consciousness, self-consciousness, and reason. When he decided to add the chapter on spirit, it was partly to explain how spirit had managed to progress rather than regress in the wake of the terror. To account for the roots of their respective protagonists' selves, sensibilities, and works, Wordsworth and Hegel had to make sense of their journey through France. That journey had begun with absolute enthusiasm for the revolutionary cause. As Wordsworth famously described it, bliss was it in that dawn to be alive, but to be young was very heaven. Hegel said much the same thing. Quote, Anaxagoras was the first to say that the world is governed by nous, but only now did people come to recognize that thought ought to govern spiritual reality. This was accordingly a glorious dawn. End quote. Hegel never wavered in his enthusiasm for this dawn, annually celebrating Bastille Day. But Wordsworth did waver. In the prelude, he claims that when he first arrived in Paris in November 1791, he had to affect more emotion than he felt as he pocketed a relic of the Bastille in the guise of an enthusiast. And although he professes to have later given his heart to the people, he eventually succumbed to despair and disgust as the consequences of the revolution unfurled. Under the belated influence of Burke, he fell back into the sort of pre-revolutionary ethical thinking that Hegel took spirit to have successively sublated. Spirit had sublated the terror by instituting the moral norms of post-revolutionary society. This was the achievement that Hegel had to recount in order to get on with the system. By contrast, the recluse would compensate for the revolution's failure. Brandom refers to the terror only in passing, but he provides a clear account of its significance for Hegel. According to him, the terror represented an extreme consequence of modernity's one-sided emphasis on the attitude dependence of normative statuses, especially the fundamental social statuses of responsibility, dependence, and authority, independence. Prior to modernity, normative attitudes were taken to be entirely dependent on independently given normative statuses. It was a genuine advance for modernity to realize that normative statuses depend on our attitudes toward them. Unfortunately, this insight made it difficult to see what traditional societies saw, namely that there is another complementary sense in which normative attitudes are answerable to instituted normative statuses. The result of this loss of knowledge was alienation. Hegel represents the French Revolution as the outcome of a festering legitimation crisis that the revolution only exacerbated. Like the king and the lords they replaced, the revolutionaries had no way of establishing political authority. Confusing freedom with total independence or mastery, they could only abstractly negate every particular will in the name of an equally abstract general will. To achieve genuine freedom, it would be necessary to balance the Enlightenment's insight into the attitude dependence of normative statuses with faith's traditional awareness of the status dependence of normative attitudes. This task, that of creating what Brandom calls a postmodern spirit of trust, has yet to be achieved. What Hegel shows at the end of his chapter on spirit is that we need to confess and forgive past crimes like the terror as deeds that we ourselves are responsible for, while at the same time asking those who come after us to forgive us for what we ourselves are unable to forgive. From this point of view, Wordsworth's inability to get past the terror could be explained as a failure to tell a forgiving story according to which those who implemented it were acting in a way that contributed to the march toward universal freedom. Hegel was able to move forward because he could tell such a story. Now, Brandom doesn't make this connection between Hegel and Wordsworth, but it's in keeping with his assessment of the significance of the terror for Hegel. Now, one unexpected feature of this assessment is that it does make Hegel more of a prophet of a world to come than a theorist of a world already achieved. For we haven't yet achieved a spirit of trust. We've only discerned the norm dictating that it should be achieved. As Brandom acknowledges, this makes the concept of a spirit of trust a kind of Kantian regulative ideal. It's a regulative ideal not only because it hasn't been implemented yet, but because even in its implemented form, it has the structure of a never-ending work in progress. The structure or experience guarantees that we'll keep committing normative lapses, that is, crimes, that need to be confessed and forgiven. Another hermeneutic implication to Brandom's picture is that Wordsworth's falling back into a pre-revolutionary mindset needn't be taken to involve nostalgia for the one-sided status dependence of attitudes characteristic of traditional society. Instead, it could be taken to represent a failure to advance from the attitude-dependent standpoint of modernity to the reciprocal-dependent standpoint of postmodernity. Such a failure would be less cognitive than recognitive, as Brandom conceives it, that is, less a matter of discerning the intrinsic meaning of the terror itself than acknowledging our responsibility to repair and forgive it. As Brandom points out, the reparative aspect of this responsibility makes it not only retrospective, but even retroactive. In this respect, we're responsible for essentially repeating the terror, a theme also prominent in the work of Slavoj Žižek. Žižek asks, in defense of lost causes, does the often deplorable actuality of revolutionary terror compel us to reject the very idea of terror? Or is there a way to repeat it in today's different historical constellation to redeem its virtual content from its actualization? Well, this is an intriguing parallel, I think, not only because Žižek's interpretation of Hegel is otherwise radically different from Brandom's, but also because Žižek has criticized Brandom's interpretation, maintaining that Hegel is a proponent not of a spirit of trust, but of a spirit of distrust. Like the phenomenology, the prelude begins with the empirical givens of sense certainty. Oh, there is a blessing in this gentle breeze. As in Hegel, a form of self-consciousness is implicitly accompanied by forms of self-consciousness and practical reason. Like Hegel's observing reason, Wordsworth seeks an objective correlative of his self in the breeze that seems half conscious of the joy it brings. The poet professes to have a heart joyous, not scared at its own liberty, but soon he is asking liberty what it would avail but for a gift that consecrates the joy. He is conscious of having received a gift from nature, but recognizes a need to give something in return. The external breeze blowing on his cheek summons a correspondent breeze within, a tempest, a redundant energy vexing its own creation. Wordsworth is looking forward to the time he has been given to write poetry, matins and vespers of harmonious verse, but he's not yet sure what to write or write about. The fact that he's telling us this in verse suggests that he has in fact decided. By making a present joy the matter of a song, he is celebrating a past joy recollected in tranquility. But he's also recording an ongoing struggle to get on with another project. The prelude is a distraction conceived as a mere tailpiece to the recluse. It was not yet, if ever, conceived by Wordsworth as a prelude. After considering and dismissing several possible topics for long poems that he could undertake to write, including his best and favorite aspiration, some philosophic song of truth that cherishes our daily life, he shrinks back from the awful burthen his days passed in contradiction. Then comes what we might call Wordsworth's second sailing. Was it for this, he asks, that one, the fairest of all rivers, loved to blend his murmurs with my nurse's song? This question leads him back to the natural consciousness of his childhood and the self-development that he and we will carefully observe for the rest of the poem until eventually the observed self-consciousness comes to coincide with that of the mature poet, a diachronic form of the I that is we and the we that is I. The demonstrative in the question, "Was it for this?" ostensibly refers to the nominally present situation that Wordsworth has just described, the writer's block that he determinately negates by posing this very question. Yet he had written the "Was it for this" passage back in 1798, before he had written the opening section or any other part of the poem. Both the 1798 fragment and the two-part prelude of 1799 begin with the question, "Was it for this?" without indicating what the demonstrative is referring to. Its free-floating character reminds us of Hegel's argument in Sense Certainty that determinate contents cannot be fixed through the use of demonstratives alone. We need to be able to distinguish the repeatable sense contents that appear on particular occasions from the unrepeatable occasions themselves. As Brandon puts it in a motto, "Dixis presupposes anaphora." That is, the ability to use demonstratives such as "this" presupposes the mastery of pronouns that refer back to antecedently given contents that could at the time have been given names. This lesson is implicitly operative in the in Wordsworth's reference to "this breeze" in the later versions of the poem. In re-beginning this way, Wordsworth anchored his poem in nature. And he also contextualized the question, "Was it for this?" by first describing the writer's block to which the previous "this" could then refer back. But in doing so, he changed the direction of the anaphoric chain of the demonstrative. In the original drafts, the word "this" and "was it for this" would most naturally, I think, be taken to refer to the unfinished poem that Wordsworth was just beginning to write. Now, Brandom observes that for Hegel, the intention to complete a work involves a kind of forward anaphora whose object is projected to appear only at the end of the intentional activity. I like the house that you're building. In this case, the object that would ground the forward anaphoric chain would be Wordsworth's finished poem. When he first wrote the words, "Was it for this?" he was not suffering from writer's block. He was getting on with the recluse just fine, albeit in fragments that he planned to synthesize later on. Only after he came to think of his poem to Coleridge as a way of procrastinating did he transform the forward anaphoric chain into a backward chain, optimistically telling himself that he was determinately negating his writer's block by telling the story of how he came both to suffer from it and to negate it. And it was around this time that he decided to discuss his experiences in France. Because closely related to his writer's block, although it isn't thematized until much later in the 1805 and 1850 versions of the poem, is his dejection over the fate of the French Revolution, spirits writer's block, as it were, and his resolve to determinately negate it by setting out in verse his views of nature, man, and society. 'Tis against that that we are writing. When Brandom contrasts Wordsworth's thought that the child is father of the man with his achievement in the prelude, he implies that Wordsworth succeeded in growing up, that his account of the growth of a poet's mind, the poem's published subtitle, represents an adult's perspective on his growing up, so that the father who left behind an unacknowledged child in France would not be the son of the boy whose experiences in the mountains of Cumberland he recounts. Whatever writer's block he may have experienced along the way would be retrospectively understood as growing pains. Okay, now Zizek's perspective is, I think, the exact opposite of this, and I realize I haven't said anything about his reading, alternative reading of Hegel. But he does refer to the prelude in the parallax view. And parallax, in what we might call its empirical sense, is the apparent displacement of a visible object due to a change in the position of the viewing subject. But for Zizek, there's a kind of transcendental parallax that involves an actual change in the status of an object that corresponds to two different points of view a subject can take on it. Kant's antinomies are exemplary instances of transcendental paradox. Kant likens all of the transcendental illusions of reason, not just the antinomies, to optical illusions that persist even after we see through them. In the special case of the antinomies, the illusion involves two incompatible points of view, such as that between the apparent necessity of determinism and the apparent necessity of free will. Kant resolves these apparent contradictions by attributing them to reason's tendency to treat appearances of things as things in themselves and then totalize them. When Hegel criticizes Kant for thereby evincing an undue tenderness for the things of this world, he appears to contend that contradiction is an inherent feature of reality. But, I talked about this in the earlier part of my paper, Zizek criticizes Brandom for attributing to Hegel this same very tenderness for things, the same criticizes Brandom for attributing to Hegel the same tenderness that Hegel attributes to Kant. Brandom's paradigmatic example of how the Hegelian dialectic works involves an ordinary optical illusion, learning to see how a stick that looks bent when it's half submerged in water is actually straight. The rational unacceptability of the apparent contradiction, the stick is bent, the stick is not bent, prompts the subject to seek a contradiction-dispelling explanation of the illusion in the laws of optics. But according to Zizek, the Hegelian dialectic does not work by generating and resolving discrepancies between the way things are in themselves and the way they appear to us. Rather, it works by generating discrepancies that belong as much to things in themselves as to our perspectives on them. Whenever such a discrepancy arises, there are two metaphysically incompatible perspectives that are separated by a gap between which the cognizing subject can only move back and forth. Zizek calls this gap a parallax object. And by way of illustration, he discusses the stolen boat episode from Book One of the Prelude. When he was a boy, Wordsworth stole a boat from a rocky cave. And as he rowed away from the shore, a huge peak that he hadn't at first been able to see suddenly loomed into view. The faster he rowed away from it, the faster the image grew, as if the peak itself were coming after him. Terrified, the boy returned to shore. Like Brandom's apparently bent stick, Wordsworth's looming crag clearly can be explained as an optical illusion. It was Wordsworth's change of position that made it seem as if the crag itself were moving rather than he himself. Of course, the child didn't understand this. After hastily returning the boat to its rightful place, he meditated on the event in grave and serious mood. Something in nature had seemed to loom before him, something that had designs upon him. Later, both in his life and in the poem, Wordsworth told himself that in fact nature did have designs upon him. In this and other spots of time, it was nature's intention to awaken the boy's imagination. This aspect of Wordsworth's mature understanding of the significance of the episode would be lost if we reduced it to a lesson in optics. Now, Brandom would surely agree with this point, but he'd probably still maintain that what disturbed the child was just an ordinary experience of empirical parallax. For Zizek, however, the optical illusion was experienced as what he calls the objectal correlate of the child's own gaze, and thus as an instance of transcendental parallax. In support of this reading, he appeals to the passage in the Immortality Ode, where Wordsworth refers to the sober coloring that clouds take from an eye that hath kept watch o'er man's mortality. The child is father of the man in the sense that the mature poet's natural piety, his heart's readiness to leap up at the sight of a rainbow, is due to an ontological lesson learned in childhood. Like the crag looming up before him, the guillotine was the objective correlate of the mature Wordsworth's gaze. Both objects elicited terror, and both were projections of the gazing subject's own negativity. This is how Zizek interprets the point. In the case of the crag, subjective negativity would have manifested itself in the cognitive power of the child's imagination. In the case of the guillotine, through the practical force of absolute freedom. In both cases, the subject can only move forward by identifying with the objects, as the Jacobins urge in the case of the guillotine, discerning its own negativity within it. Yet in both cases, Wordsworth turned back, as the Girondists did in the case of the guillotine. The stolen boat episode could be read as a kind of screen memory for Wordsworth's later memories of France, his recollection of the voice of mountain echoes echoing the name La Montagne that was given to the Jacobins in the National Assembly. And I admit that might be a bit of a wild interpretation. In both experiences, Wordsworth treated a terrifying object as an occasion for reflecting on the power of his imagination and its relation to nature. Instead of initiating a conflict between reason and imagination, as in Kant's account of the dynamical sublime, Wordsworth took nature to have taught him to think of imagination as reason in her most exalted mood. Now, for Brandom, there's a kind of transcendental parallax in the double perspective we take in representing a tradition, both prospectively as instituting a norm and retrospectively as expressing a norm. Yet Brandom, like Kant, denies that there's such a thing as a parallax object, an ontological gap in the very fabric of reality. Zizek seems to think that from this it follows that Brandom recoils from the negativity embodied in the terror, just as Wordsworth did. But is this really so? For Brandom, the terror represents the most extreme form of the attitude dependence of normative statuses unsupported by reciprocal sense status dependence of normative attitudes. To get beyond the terror, to pass from modernity to postmodernity, it's necessary to take responsibility for it. The point of the dialectic of confession and forgiveness for Brandom is not just to take responsibility for actions that we ourselves have personally performed. To restrict responsibility in this way is to remain within the one-sided attitude dependent perspective of modernity. To balance this perspective with the Zwicky perspective on status dependence requires that we reclaim an aspect of the heroic conception of agency, according to which an agent is responsible for their entire deed, not only the intentional part that they consciously foresaw, but the consequential part that they couldn't have foreseen. Each of us is responsible for everything that everyone does on Brandom's reading of Hegel, both diachronically and synchronically. The need to confess and to ask for forgiveness extends for all of us, collectively and distributively, all the way back to the terror, as well as earlier and subsequent and present crimes. But this is one of Zizek's fundamental themes as well, the necessity to take responsibility for past failures while striving to fail better, as he says, borrowing a phrase from Beckett. Zhou Enlai famously, supposedly, said in 1972 that it was too early to tell whether the French Revolution had succeeded or not. For both Zizek and Brandom, it's always too soon to tell because the ever-expanding consequences and aspirational repetitions of human deeds are unforeseeable. The basic difference between their perspectives on the phenomenology, which might be characterized as an instance of parallax itself, is that Brandom thinks of Hegelian subjects as normative agents who oblige themselves to resolve contradictions, whereas Zizek thinks of Hegelian subjects as agents of negation whose responsibility is to actualize them. But if the generation and resolution of contradictions are two sides of the same dialectical coin, this massive difference may simply reflect two necessary perspectives on one and the same object. The fact that Hegel succeeded or failed better than Wordsworth in forgiving the terror is an insight that Brandom and Zizek both enable us to see from their otherwise incompatible points of view. Okay, thank you.
That was perfect timing.
Good.
We had good for discussion. Yeah.
I'm trying to figure out whether I believe the world is tender in the way that Hegel is accusing of Kant and the way that Zizek is accusing Brandom of thinking that Hegel is. Did I get it right? So I was wondering if you could say more about what you think it means for the contradiction to be inherent in the thing in itself and how that can be a Hegelian view, since it seems like, I mean, it could be, it's kind of ambiguous, right? It could mean that there's always a contradiction coming up once you overcome the last one and move on. Or it could mean there's these actual contradictions. So I was just wondering if you could say more about that.
Yes, thank you very much. And I have the same question, I guess. And I guess, when I think about this, I think in terms of contemporary readers of Hegel, I think of a Graham Priest as being sort of at one extreme because he happily attributes his own dialetheism to Hegel. Hegel thinks there are contradictions everywhere. And Brandom is sort of the other extreme where there are no contradictions in reality itself. And they both seem somehow unsatisfying to me as readings of Hegel, aside from just this question about what philosophical position we should hold. The thing about dialetheism in general, I guess I would say philosophically, is that it seems remarkably frictionless to allow these contradictions, as though once we suspend the law of non-contradiction, it's like, so what? It's not clear that there's any dialectical force involved in what we previously had thought of as, the two sides of a contradiction, when we're shaken by it, moved, agitated. But on the other hand, Brandom's suggestion that, yeah, it's all just about resolving experiential errors that we make and coming to see that there never was any way in which reality was inherently contradictory, that at least doesn't feel right as a reader of Hegel. You know, and in terms of the question that you're raising here, I mean, one way that I might try to, you know, kind of break it down, and maybe this will play into Pierre's paper as well, is in terms of maybe sort of structural versus dynamical ways of thinking about reality. Because if we think of reality as just sort of statically, static versus dynamic, if we think of reality as static in some sense, then what it would mean to think of it as contradictory or not means one thing. And if we think of it as dynamic, then it means something else. I definitely think Hegel has a dynamic conception of reality. So then it's not going to be like, yeah, bend stick, because Brandom sort of begins by saying, well, that would be ridiculous if Hegel thought that the stick really was bent, and now it's not really not bent. It makes Hegel look like, it makes the priest view look kind of silly, right? So I think that you have to read Hegel dynamically in order to get the view that there are metaphysical contradictions off the ground. And then I guess I do think that, and then I probably am a little bit closer to Zizek on this one, in thinking that that there is some ontological significance to contradiction. Yeah. Thank you.
One of the things that I was thinking about as you were talking was Marx and Marx's relation to Hegel. What I sense is, first of all, that you're trying to sort of triangulate a relation between Hegel, well, let's put it this way, Brandom, Zizek, and Wordsworth. And so Wordsworth is the third. When, you know, Marx reads Hegel, one of the objectives is to abolish contradictions. So with Hegel, there's a maintenance of the dialectical structure through the maintenance of, say, a dialectical relation between equality and inequality. And you can maintain that, right, in a civil society from a Hegelian standpoint. But that contradiction has to be abolished if we're going to follow Marx. We have to radicalize equality and freedom. And so with reference to the terror, and for example, the guillotine, right, there would have to be a coincident abolition of the guillotine in order to sort of achieve absolute freedom, which would in effect require us to be free from the fear of punishment. And so that, in effect, if you're Marx, right, really sort of requires some kind of transformation in human nature. So what I'm trying to sort of, so using that, right, to try to think with you with through what I just heard, I wonder if you could sort of explain a little bit more about how you see Wordsworth triangulating the relation between Brandom and Zizek.
Thank you. I have to think about this one. I guess my first thought is that I think Marx represents the French Revolution as ushering in bourgeois society. It's a bourgeois revolution that's that needs to be completed by a proletarian revolution. And when he starts to reflect on what the future revolution will bring and how, you know, it can't look back on the on previous revolutions for inspiration in the way that previous revolutions did, he's got some kind of a conception of the asymmetry between looking forward and looking back. And I think that Marx, like Hegel, does have a dynamical conception of history. It does involve the working out of contradictions and generating of contradictions. I was thinking about what you were saying about seeing Marx as critical of Hegel's view of contradiction. I guess my take would be he's critical insofar as he thinks of Hegel as misplacing the locus of contradiction rather than being critical of Hegel for thinking that there are genuine contradictions. I mean, the nature of contradiction is such a thorny question in some way. And, you know, again, why I find a priest's dialetheism unsatisfying is because it seems to take the dynamic aspect out of what a contradiction is from a dialectical point of view. So that somehow, as dialectical thinkers, Hegel and Marx do have a view of the history of the world playing out a series of contradictions. But they have different analyses in many respects about where these contradictions arise and how exactly they're to be worked out.
I actually had a thought and a question along these lines. At the end of the paper, we get Brandom on Hegelian subjects and Zizek on Hegelian subjects, but the Wordsworth kind of drops out in the very last part of the paper. And I wondered if it might help to think about the kind of contradiction that occurs, that concerns you, more explicitly from the side of the subject and from the side of the Wordsworthian subject in particular. And the thought would be that there is in Wordsworth a drive or a pledge to resolve contradiction, to become an achieved, authoritative, confident subject who has worked through and overcome trauma, but who nonetheless finds himself repeatedly unable to do that, partly because the form in which trauma is encountered is always and worked through is always in these screen memories that never involve full confrontation with the real, as it were, leaving a subject who suffers from a kind of permanent trauma or déhiscence. If that's all going on in Wordsworth, and I think it is, I kind of think he got it right and Hegel didn't. Is that where you might like to go?
So I'm tempted just to say I agree with absolutely everything there, except the last thing I have to think about a little bit more. I mean, I skipped the whole middle part of my paper where it really is about Hegel, and then we're turning to Wordsworth in order to see if can this help us to resolve the tension between these two radically different readings of Hegel and Hegelian subjectivity. But I take what you're suggesting as the solution as a completely friendly view, and I think Brandom would completely accept your characterization of Wordsworth here. It's why what he is thinking of essentially when he thinks of this analogy between the prelude and the phenomenology. What strikes me is that with Zizek and Wordsworth and Brandom, it's almost as though there's only that in a sense they do have the same picture, but are looking at it from two incompatible perspectives, with the one emphasizing success and the other emphasizing failure. You know, the Bob Dylan line there, she knows there's no success like failure, and that failure is no success at all. That could characterize the position on Hegel that they each take in a certain way. I don't think Zizek has read Brandom carefully enough to see that Brandom really is sensitive to the idea that failure is an ongoing necessary thing, and that indeed all that we can keep doing is confronting our failures and resolving, exactly as you said, to resolve them. Whether that picture is different from Hegel's picture, I think that would be the question. I think what Brandom would say if he were here is, well, that is Hegel's picture, is that it is the Wordsworthian result that you were describing.
Following in this on this line of thought, I'm tempted to think of the dichotomy between failed mourning and successful mourning, mourning and melancholy. And in that respect, of course, Wordsworth would be the melancholic and then the continuing creator, poetic creator, trying to reach that kind of reconciliation and unable to do so. While Hegel, you know, with his The Odyssey, that for which he is so much reviled, he successfully tried or succeeded to overcome that. Do you think that would make any sense, or that would speak in a different way, making this clear?
Yes, so I do. I completely agree. And you know, I use the word dejection to characterize Wordsworth's emotional response to the French Revolution, because that's Coleridge's word in his ode on dejection. But I think absolutely for both of them, they never come to terms with this object that they are unable to successfully mourn. And indeed, the way that Derrida always reads Hegel as, you know, a kind of triumphalist succeeder at mourning, Yeah, there might be a way to read Hegel here. I mean, I guess I take the spirit of your contrast to be sort of like Richard's contrast in a way, where the Wordsworthian position turns out to just look morally better in a certain way because it's less triumphalist in the end. You know, what I think, again, just to try and, you know, I see myself as trying to get Brandom and Zizek to have a conversation with each other. I think they could both agree that Hegel is only, as Brandom puts it, Whiggish in a kind of knowing way. It's not that, you know, yes, history is all good, but we simply resolve to tell a story looking at the successes while retelling the failures in such a way that they're part of the story. And to the extent that we fail to do that, he says, we hope to be forgiven by future generations who will forgive us. So one way that we might apply that here is to think that if I'm in, you know, like what Derrida calls mid-mourning, if I'm in mid-mourning or if I'm in a kind of melancholy state, unable to mourn, in a sense I might proleptically hope that others will be able to mourn or to complete my incompleted work of mourning.
Okay, I want to go back to the contradiction issue. I mean, one of the things that complicates this is that Hegel uses contradiction in a very specific sense. But I think in the end, one can actually show that the very notion of identity that I think Brandom presupposes involves a Hegelian contradiction. It involves the relation between two terms which have to be taken to be identical. So they're both different and identical and constitutively so. You can't have identity just as a relation of something to itself because then it's not relating. So it has to relate to itself as the other term of the relationship. So it seems to me that in this position, which actually bothered Wittgenstein a lot in the Tractatus of how to think about identity, how do we prevent it from being a relation, and so on, you get an insight actually into some of the assumptions that are built into Brandom's own account. We gotta stay away from anything that smells of a contradiction. We have to hold on to things that are conceptually real independently of what we endeavor to do. And the task of Hegel is, in a sense, to come up with the comprehensive tracking of all of that. I don't think any of that is a correct interpretation of Hegel, and I think that's demonstrable. So while I don't think that Hegel is committed to taking contradictions as final, right? They actually appear rather early in the logic of essence, and they're ultimately dissolved in the process of that logic. But the dissolution still leaves a place for them in the dynamic of human understanding and even of our conception of what a God's eye view is, because after all, that's only a conception. My point is, you don't have to go to Zizek's position to see that there are difficulties in Brandom's position. My objection to Zizek here is that he actually makes Hegel out to be committed to things that Hegel need not be committed to. I, for one, think that all of these commitments come up already in Kant anyway. The problem is that whenever we deal with anything in isolation, we take it as if it were a thing in itself. Well, in a certain sense, as human beings, to know something, we have to take it as if in isolation. That commits us, in a way, to taking things as they are in themselves. But then we realize that that's actually in fundamental conflict with the conditions of human knowledge. And this is actually the way that Karatani, who introduces this notion of perspective and that Zizek gets it from, interprets Kant, that you're committed to this fundamental antinomy, really, in that you always have to take things to be independent of our point of view, but at the same time recognizing that our point of view is a finite one and located. So in this sense, we're always caught up in that contradiction.
Yes, thank you, Pierre. I agree with, I think, everything you're saying here. You know, Brandom interprets determinant negation as material incompatibility. He interprets mediation as material consequence. And so he ends up with a kind of differential way of thinking about conceptual content. But what he doesn't want, above all, is to have it be differential all the way down. He wants there to be something that experientially is given immediately. And why Sellars is so helpful for him is because Sellars enables him to think about that which can be registered non-inferentially, even though it's only registered conceptually and therefore as available for inferential processing. That experiential point is connected to some kind of metaphysical point about there being some independent ways things are, that grounds their relations to one another. And that is exactly what Zizek attacks him on. You're right, I don't have to do this all through Zizek. I kind of wanted to do through Zizek because I like bringing disparate thinkers together and because I like the idea that we could return to Wordsworth here in some way, that it was this curious thing that they both dealt with Wordsworth. But in any case, Brandom thinks, at one point he attributes the view to Derrida, that they're nothing but signifiers, that if we go this purely differential route, it just kind of bottoms out with nothing whatsoever. I don't think he has that conception of the thing in itself merely as the thing with purely monadic properties. I think he thinks, noumenal reality is something we need to preserve as just the determinate way things are. And indeed, once we think more structurally, some of these problems might go away.
You all know him. Pierre Keller is the author of two books, by my count, Heidegger and Human Experience from Cambridge in 1999, Kant and the Demands of Self-Consciousness, also from Cambridge in 1998, with bunches of papers on Kant, Heidegger, Hegel, Whitehead, an interesting figure for these discussions, and Leibniz, also an interesting figure. He's from the University of California at Riverside, and he's going to talk about dynamic structuralism and the parallax view.
I've been asked maybe to put what I'm doing in a bit of context. I've been trying to rethink the way one approaches a variety of historical figures and also philosophy in general. And I have started to sort of reorganize the conception, at least that I have, of the history of philosophy and of what matters in philosophy. My view is that most of contemporary philosophy is dominated by a paradigm that was set by the Vienna Circle, by Russell and by Carnap and Schlick, a neo-Humean conception that is then read into texts going back to Plato and beyond and forward. And in each of these texts, the positions of the authors are found to be wanting because they fail to measure up to the standards of a neo-Humean conception. Now, the one problem that I see with that is that a neo-Humean conception is an inadequate conception, and it has been demonstrated to be inadequate by philosophers beginning at least with Kant, who actually, on my view, rejected the very basis for the neo-Humean response to Hume as inadequate in the Prolegomena, when he said that Beattie and Reed and philosophers like them had just misunderstood what Hume was trying to get at. Hume had never doubted what they took him to be calling into question. And then Kant sets off on a discussion that most people find completely irrelevant. He says, look, the problem with Hume's view is that Hume came to be worried about skepticism. He worried that there might be these hidden shoals as one was crossing the waters that would get one shipwrecked. And so he took the option, instead of going out on these dangerous ocean voyages, of finding a small island and setting things up there. What Kant proposes in the Prolegomena explicitly is now to set sail on the wide seas of metaphysics with a compass in hand of the critique, and that compass consists in the ability to orient oneself within the comprehensive context of what matters and see how everything is differentially and structurally related to each other. And that is already Kant's response to Hume in the first edition of the Critique of Pure Reason, which most Kant scholars can't even see. They all agree that this is a complete failure, because it is on neo-Humean grounds, right? Kant already argues in the first edition of the Critique that you can't see things in isolation from each other. You have to see them in terms of a pattern of epistemic, temporal, spatial, but also social and pragmatic significance. So Kant's response to Hume in the first edition of the Critique is not complete until the very end of the first Critique. Most people think it stops sometime after the second analogy of experience, right? Because they can't fit all of these parts together, even though that's what Kant himself in both editions of the Critique encourages one to do. Okay, now I'll read some stuff on Kant's idea of the Copernican revolution. So, in German philosophy in the last two centuries, the idea of a Copernican revolution in Kant was thought to be absolutely central to the significance of his work. But beginning with Russell and Norman Kemp Smith, most Anglo-American commentators have struggled to find any significance in it at all. And this is because they've generally taken the view that what Kant must be doing when he is encouraging us to look at the standards of the knower as opposed to the objects of metaphysics and taking them as given, well, they take it what Kant must be doing is taking metaphysical objects and sticking them into the mind so that they become represented objects. I mean, there are thousands of books that say these things, and it's taught, I think, every day throughout the country as Kant's view, but it's absolute nonsense. Okay, and I'll sort of spell out a bit of what I think the correct view is, because I think if you understand Kant correctly, you see that the Critique of Pure Reason is not only still a work worth reading, it's actually philosophically superior to all of the leading works in epistemology, metaphysics, and the philosophy of science today, because people haven't learned its key insights. I mean, I have a long discussion of why that's so in contemporary philosophy of science and so on. I'll be happy to talk to you about that if you like. Okay, so I want to read Kant's position and the central positions of thinkers in especially the continental philosophical tradition as developing a dynamic structuralism, by which I mean that everything is understood in terms of its structural relations. Nothing has being independent of these structural relations. But these structural relations are also not independent of us, and we aren't independent of them, nor are they independent of nature or any of the things that they're often taken to be independent of. So the idea is understanding things from the ground up in terms of the process of the constitution of oneself, other persons, and other objects in a process that's intrinsically dynamic, not static, not putting things together that are already there, but understanding how things develop from the get-go. And that applies on Kassir's view and Heidegger's and the leading thinker Jaspers of the 20th century, also to mathematics and logic. I could go into that. Okay, but let me go back to the Copernican revolution. So a common way of downplaying the significance of Copernicus's revolution is that in Copernicus it amounts to simply switching from a geocentric to a heliocentric view of the solar system, a switch not entirely original to Copernicus. Similarly, in Kant, it is supposed to amount merely to replacing an object by a subject-centric perspective, such that the individual subject now imposes, that's Paul Guyer's work, a subjective conceptual scheme on the world. That impositionist interpretation of the Copernican revolution makes it impossible to do justice to the conception of the parallax view in Kant, for it imposes a structure on the cosmos that blots out our own position in the structure and in the cosmos, as well as our own standpoint-dependent systematic relation to the cosmos. So just to explain what I mean here, on most people's view of what's going on with Kant's Copernican revolution, you have the static set of structural relations that are taken to be a priori, and then we impose that structure on the world. But then the problem with that account is how our changing standpoint in the world can be relevant to those objects and structures, given that that changing standpoint has dropped out because we've simply imposed this abstract structure on the world that leaves no space for standpoint dependence. Okay, so what I'm going to argue for, and what I take to be, if you will, the continental philosophical conception of the Copernican revolution, is that the very notion of systematic structure involves a conception of systematic structure, not from a God's eye point of view of objectivity, but from the vantage point that each of us and all of us occupy in the world. So there's no structure here to be had that isn't from a standpoint within the world. Okay, and I take that to be a common denominator between Kant, Hegel, Hölderlin, Heidegger, Kassir, Jaspers, and so on. I mean, to me, it's absolutely surprising that this should be controversial, but it is. Okay, so Kassir, I'll just take him as an example, has a very different and much richer understanding of Copernicus's and Kant's revolution in thought. It's my contention that understanding the rich structure of the Copernican and Kantian revolution in thought involves a grip on a comprehensive and inclusive, but also fundamentally situated structural systematicity that makes post-Kantian thought and science truly comprehensible for the first time. I take the parting of the ways between analytic and continental philosophy to occur in the concept of structure. Analytic philosophy sees in principle individual minds connected together in an objective world by logical, mathematical, and causal relations, and also social relations. But the point is, you start from these individual minds and then you work out somehow to an objective world. Good luck. Okay, so that's Kant's response to Hume. So continental philosophy takes relations to be constitutive, but does not take even logic, mathematics, or causation to be independent of the temporal and historical process and social process in which we are embedded as human beings, and that gives even mathematics and logic their distinctive significance. Okay, so this is the revolution that I want to ascribe to Kant. And I think to understand that, you have to go all the way, you have to read the book, the first critique to the very end, and also read the other ones, by the way, too. But if you think that you can understand Kant by taking isolated passages and being puzzled about how they could possibly be freestanding, then you're simply expressing your own puzzlement at why Kant fails to fit the methodology that you want to impose on him and on everything else, a methodology that I personally find philosophically bankrupt. Okay, I take Kassir, but also others, to be fellow travelers in it. I mean, I'm not saying this is obvious. It has taken me a half century to see that the standard readings of all of these authors are just completely wrong, and that one needs to radically rethink things. Okay, so Kassir starts by observing the following about Copernicus. A central part of his novel approach to astronomy is indeed a kind of reversal, but at a methodological or epistemological level. Copernicus reverses the traditional Aristotelian order of perception and theory. As Galileo already pointed out, instead of taking perception as a criterion for scientific truth, like Aristotle and like most empiricist views, like the neo-Humean view of perception and of agency, Copernicus takes the, and here's a quote, the true mathematical form and the harmony of the world order to be the criterion for the truth of sensation. That's from Kassir. In fact, by replacing the sensory illusion that the Earth is stationary with a pure thought construction of scientific experience, Copernicus turns the question of the true world order into a general question of method, how to proceed basically in constructing systematically this world order, and then placing perception and our standpoint in construction of the world. That's actually how Copernicus proceeds. Okay, in the preface to his book on revolutions, Copernicus criticizes Ptolemaic astronomy for failing systematically to connect the orbit sizes and distances of the planets. He uses a striking analogy in this context. It's as though an artist were to gather the hands, feet, and head and other members for his image from different models. And since they in no way match each other, the result would be a monster rather than a man. So what Copernicus is objecting to in Ptolemaic astronomy is not really its description of the paths of the individual planets or of the stars. He thinks he can at best make gradual progress on that score. What he is objecting to is that in Ptolemaic astronomy, all of these trajectories can be taken in complete abstraction from one another. So you can have a description of the path of Venus, you can have a description of the path of the Earth, and they don't have to fit together. There were some efforts in Ptolemy to then provide a mechanical model for how this works. But mathematically, the orbits of the individual planets and the stars are completely independent of each other for Ptolemy. And this is what Copernicus is fundamentally objecting to. So about the only person who puts the kind of emphasis that I would on this quote is Kuhn and in his The Copernican Revolution, which is where I was quoting from, but I think he doesn't quite articulate the point as distinctly as he might. And I could go into that if you want. So picking up on Copernicus's analogy, Kassir elaborates his objection to the lack of systematicity in Ptolemaic astronomy as follows. The Ptolemaic worldview, the theory of epicycles, does not articulate a strictly unitary conception. Instead, it is forced to develop a separate picture for each particular circle of appearances that it contemplates. This theory can be compared to a painting in which the artist has very well executed all individual parts without portraying a single individual and without putting those individual members in a determinate harmonic relationship, so that the whole result is more comparable to a monster than a human being. So for Kassir, the Copernican revolution consists at its core of reconceiving the true world order as a unitary, structured whole, a cosmic order independent of direct perception, and to be reconstructed structurally, systematically, from the changing standpoint of a moving Earth within the solar system. This goes already significantly beyond the common interpretation of Copernicus. Kassir goes further. In conceiving of the planets, the sun, the stars, and the moon in terms of their systematic, structural, functional relatedness in a cosmic order, Copernicus fundamentally alters the meaning of what it is to be a celestial and eventually a terrestrial body. That is, what it is to be a planet, including the Earth now. It is in this process that the question of the true as opposed to the perceived world order is transformed into one of method and of the process in which things are constituted in their very identity. The cosmos is here interpreted as a pure thought construction of scientific experience, which then allows us systematically to reconstruct how things must appear to us from our changing vantage point within that construction of scientific experience. Going even further than that, Kassir takes the Copernican approach to extend well beyond the science of astronomy by bringing with it a whole new conception of the systematic unity, not only of the cosmos, but also of culture. The unity of the mathematical concept includes the unity of aesthetic intuition in itself. Both factors reciprocally complete each other and only thereby achieve their own inner completion. What we have here is not only a change in the content of the concept of nature, but the change that takes place in the picture of objective reality also immediately determines the content and the character of the cultural sciences. A new ethical attitude to life and a new way of looking at the world and value expresses itself in this conception. In other words, for Kassir, Copernicus offers a new and comprehensive understanding of culture oriented around astronomy, one that includes aesthetic, ethical, social, and historical considerations, not as add-ons, but in a fundamental way. This new understanding goes explicitly further back in history on Copernicus's conception and then later that of Newton and Leibniz and Kepler. It goes back beyond the Aristotelian geocentric conception of Ptolemaic astronomy. Namely, it goes back, according to Copernicus, Kepler, and Newton, to the Pythagorean tradition of a moving Earth embedded in a cosmic mathematical harmony that is structured around a pyrocentric center. Astronomy, for all of these thinkers, and especially then for Copernicus, is therefore the highest of the liberal arts, because it enables one to rise to the level of seeing one's place in the cosmos, and thus allows one to liberate oneself from one's position in the here and now of Earth. That's an idea that Kant starts from in his earliest writings and puts at the end of a famous conclusion to the Critique of Practical Reason, where he sees two things that fill him with ever-increasing wonder, the starry heavens above and the moral law within. And in that same context, he then relates the aesthetics of the beautiful and the sublime to these notions. Okay, so what I'm actually insisting on is that if you look at the guts of the major thinkers of modernity, they have a conception that's completely at odds with the general take of people in the philosophy of science, who think that Newton didn't care about anything else but mechanics, right? And then they have to throw out half of Newton's corpus. Kant was just a Newtonian in that sense, right? And so on and so on. All I'm saying is, let's look at the whole picture, and then we get a completely different conception of what science is about. Science isn't about looking at abstract billiard balls as they bounce off each other. That's an abstraction, even for physics. You can't deal with three bodies except through approximation. So how do you, can you describe that accurately? Okay, so my point isn't to denigrate any of that stuff. It's just to say that science already, and is seen by its most successful agents, involved in the process of seeing the structural significance of things both in the abstract and then in their more comprehensive relevance to what we do. Okay, I'll stop.
Thank you not only for your insights, but for your passion. You're clearly, this is important stuff. I think brilliantly reverted to Pythagoras. And one of the things that Pythagoras said was that the whole world was made of numbers. And everybody kind of knows about Pythagoras. He had a rough contemporary called Protagoras, who said that man is the measure of all things. And that's the tension that I see you working through. And I just want to share something from my own discipline, which is economics. And as I'm teaching economics, which has been very highly mathematicized, just as Anglo-American philosophy has been mathematicized, I try to stress that there's a difference between doing mathematics and doing economics. Because the beauty of mathematics is that a number is just a number. And you can use it and manipulate it according to rules, but it's just a number. Whereas in economics, unless it relates to something in the world, then you're not truly doing economics. And that points us to something that we've learned, is that economics is largely about choice. And I think in many ways, the distinction between continental philosophy and Anglo-American philosophy is a different position on the values on which choice is based. And in continental philosophy, and in the tradition that you're trying to probe more deeply, you have values that are not enumerated. They're based upon very complex relations. And so I really, you got me at the start, where you started to talk about where do we stand in terms of each other, where do we stand in terms of the physical world that we live in, and where do we stand, you know, in terms of the way we think about those things. You know, so I just, in terms of comment, think that you've made a great contribution to this paper. And my question is, do you see this analysis on the difference between a numbers-based value system and one that's a more transcendental value system? as being at the heart of what you're saying.
I don't want to say I'm in sympathy with what you're saying, since you were too kind. That's the part that I'm maybe least sympathetic. It's part of my view that the way things have been set up by people like Carnap and Reichenbach when they came to America is to say, look, the pragmatists and the continental philosophers, they don't take mathematics, logic, and the like seriously. We do. Of course, you know, there were people sitting in Princeton like Hermann Weyl and Gödel who had a very different view, people who had an actually low opinion of Carnap and Reichenbach as logicians and philosophers. But my point isn't to throw sand on the other position. My point is really this, that you don't have to give up on the precision of mathematics. You don't have to give up any of this to recognize that when you're trying to think of things in very precise terms, that's a selective process. And then when it becomes problematic only when you forget that selective process is a reflection of your interest. And then you think you've got the things as they are independently of human interest. That's the illusion that I think almost all analytic philosophers share, and I just find it an illusion. It's not that I think we have to give up on objectivity. I don't think there's anything wrong with mathematical models in economics. I do think there's something wrong with taking as the fundamental model of a human chooser the rational preference model, because it involves a high abstraction. And once you've got that abstraction in play, you can't bring everything back through the back door. So that would be my criticism of contemporary economics. It works with high abstractions, but fails often to recognize the role of those abstractions, which is completely unproblematic as long as they're seen for the abstractions that they are.
You're one of the only people that I have heard say that they are interested in trying to rethink the history of philosophy. And that's something that I am also interested in doing. That's something that I take myself to be doing. Incidentally, the figure of Copernicus is also important for me. I want to hear from you really more about where you started your speech today, right? The assertion that Copernicus is somehow important for you in rethinking the history of philosophy. You know, when I sort of think about this and listening to you, I'm thinking about books like David Lochterman's The Ethics of Geometry, even Jacob Klein's book on mathematics, ancient Greek mathematics. I'd like to ask you if you could say a little bit more about how you understand the importance of the figure of Copernicus for rethinking the history of philosophy.
Okay, yeah, that's involved, but let me say that one of the things that I've always thought is that the thought of other cultures, including the Islamicate and Maya and cosmology, and are important and should be taken seriously. Most philosophers don't really do that, or they add it as a kind of addition to their CV to make them seem a little bit sexier. But they don't really ultimately take it seriously, except insofar as it translates into contemporary view. I just feel very differently about that, and I find that the history of cosmology and astronomy in particular is really interesting in terms of the way that different cultures have either developed views that were not influential because they were too geographically isolated, like those in North and South America, or actually influenced the development of astronomy. I'm thinking of the Babylonian the Egyptian contribution, the Islamic contribution, and I could go on, that all go into the Copernican revolution and seeded it, right? And the interesting thing is that Newton, for instance, was actually very well aware of this. I mean, there's this really surprising passage where he says, the Greeks were just philologists. They didn't really contribute anything to science. All of the science comes from the ancient Egyptians and the Babylonians. So, you know, this kind of parochialism is actually fairly recent. And what I want to say, too, is that the parochialism in terms of cosmology is reflected in a parochialism about ethics. What I find most gripping in Kant is the conception of the unification of the sense that we have of our position in the physical cosmos with a sense of our role in the wider cosmos that we can only elevate ourselves to by seeing things within the comprehensive context of the a notion of experience that makes that transparent to us.
I'm really taken with what you call the continental read of the Copernican Revolution. I also find it really, I think I'm coming around to it, but I also find it really difficult not to kind of default to the just reversal view. And so I'm trying to understand more what is significant about your view and Kassir's view of it. And in particular, I would invite you to just say more about this idea, and I'll quote your paper here, where he turns the question of the true world order to the question of method. And it'd be helpful if you could say more about the question of method there.
I guess I could start with Kant on this, and what I take to actually be in the end Kassir's reading of Kant, though I may be the only person who does. So it's just as much mine, I guess. On Kant's view, famously he starts with judgments, and most people think those judgments are sort of these isolated things and you put them together somehow and the like. Okay, what Kassir focuses on is paragraph 19 of the Transcendental Deduction, and that begins with a heading that the logical form of judgment is nothing but the objective unity of apperception of the contents contained therein. Okay, that's a mouthful, but what it signifies is that Kant thinks that the logical form of judgment is itself constituted by its relation to the standpoint that we occupy as we think of our standpoint within a global context, the objective unity of apperception that relates all the different possible standpoints and their systematic structural relatedness together. Okay, so on my view, and I take this to be actually the view of Fichte, Schelling, Hegel, and the Marburg school, and really Heidegger, and I could name a whole bunch of other thinkers. So on my view, this is where the constructivism of German idealism comes from. It's the idea is you start from your I, right? But it's not really your I, because your I is just a standpoint within your ability to grasp the different points of view. So everything particular in this way is always understood in terms of its differential relatedness to a structure. Now you start with an abstract structure, and if you're especially in the Carnapian tradition, you're going to be already jittery about the global structure that I'm displaying in the form of judgment. But you're still going to insist, well, it's all from the vantage point of available from the vantage point of methodological solipsism, where I treat myself as alone in the world. Of course, that the result of that is that, you know, you got worries about where are the other people, the other things, and now that's a mystery. But, you know, that's a worry down the hill. Okay, now, that's a worry that I think you address from the get-go, because you reject the very notion that you have a grip on yourself in a contrastive way that doesn't involve a grip on your situation in the world. And so the whole idea that there might not be any other people or there might not be any other things really makes no sense. Basically, my point is that this operates at the level of every kind of object or structure. So analytic interpreters of Kant, for instance, who are interested in mathematics, wonder when Kant is talking about mathematical construction, and he's suggesting that we construct a triangle in our imagination. And they ask themselves, well, if all I have to go on is this triangle in my imagination, then how do I know, you know, what permutations to perform on it to get results that show something significant? And my response to that is that your very grip on the triangle as a geometrical triangle involves a systematic competence with respect to these permutations. And that's actually the reading of Kassir and Hermann Weyl on this point. So it isn't that we were these psychologically isolated individuals who then stare at mental particulars. That's the neo-Humean view, right? It's that our very grip on the notion that we're engaging with a triangle or a circle or a book or a table involves a conception of how this is structurally related to other geometric structures and other physical structures. Just like our grip on the paths of the planets and of the stars in the Copernican model is dependent on our grip on the whole systematic structure and not prior to it. Right? That's the key move, that we're agents in the world who come to form a systematic conception of the world. And now we have to make systematic sense of how we're competent to do that. We don't start from isolated items. That doesn't make any sense.
I'd like to press you on that last point just a little bit, the we who do that. So I'm broadly sympathetic to rejecting a Humean standpoint and rejecting any kind of methodological individualism. But there are relations, and then there are relations. The relations being to the left of and weighing 37 grams more than do not look much like the relation having a normatively structured view on or self-consciously making a judgment about. What about these beings who, part of the structure, have this distinctive kind of relation to the other elements? Can you say more about that?
As Kassir would say, that's the topic of the philosophy of symbolic form. The idea is that you can't approach ourselves or the world as just these isolated items. You approach things within contexts of significance and differential significance. So economics looks at things one way, physics looks at things another way, and within physics, statistical mechanics looks at things differently than, say, thermodynamics and so on and so forth, or physical chemistry, okay? So within the sciences themselves, you have different contexts of significance, and each of these contexts is systematically structured or can come to be seen in its systematic structure and is systematically different from other structures. So to take an example that Heidegger uses of this, the work world involves these tools that are a part of a systematic context of relatedness. I just pick up the hammer and not know what to do and so on. And that's one of these forms. So I'm What I'm most fundamentally pushing back against is the temptation, which I think is just illusion, to assume that there are a certain set of fundamental objects and then to look at everything else as just tacked onto that. We don't have any access to such fundamental objects. What we do have is access to things that matter more to us in certain contexts than in others, and we look at those in terms of shared perspective. So there's nothing, on my view, relativistic about this. Relativism kicks in when you have this notion of an independent characterization, and then we're unable to reach us. Okay. Did that answer your question?
I'm not sure. What I'm really asking is, isn't there something different about human subjects' relation to other things from the kind of relation that other things stand into other things? Something different about Dasein or reflectiveness or something like that?
I want to say yes and no. So the reason I say yes and no is I'm absolutely unsympathetic to either the view that there's no difference or the view that the difference is a fundamental one. You know, it's different whether I'm contemplating my viscera, to use Whitehead's expression, thinking about what's going on in my gut. Well, of course, he's using that in a different sense, but my point is when you're, you know, thinking about yourself as an embodied individual, then you might be thinking of yourself slightly differently than when you're thinking about yourself as thinking about mathematics or philosophy or whatever. But then the temptation is to say, well, there are these two things, the Cartesian ego and the body, the extended thing, and how do you put the two together? And from my point of view, most contemporary philosophy has not gotten beyond Cartesianism. It really, and the reason that it can't is because it thinks that there has to be a certain set of fundamental objects. And ideally, those are objects described in terms of physics. But then if they're not, don't they have to have funny mental properties, too? And you're off and running, right? So you're stuck in this debate, which goes back in the near term to the 20s of physicalism, where, well, you know, if it's describable in intersubjective, objective terms, it has to be purely physical. What do you do with everything else? That's just garbage, emotions and stuff like that. Now, my view is that's not garbage. What's happened here is that you've got a case of what Whitehead calls the fallacy of misplaced concreteness. You think that because a certain object or event is fundamental in a certain physical view to which you're committed, that it therefore is fundamental in some absolute sense. And that's just an illusion. That's transcendental illusion in Kant's term. So that's what I take the parallax view, also in the Caratani interpretation, to be fundamentally about. That we look at things both from our point of view and from other points of view, and we then think that we need to compare our point of view to an absolute point of view so that it can be true. And there's some, in a certain sense, we do, because we want to get the truth. But that leads us to the illusion that we got that, right?
I find myself in this discussion, on the one hand, very compelled by the systematicity and the structural, but then as I'm compelled by that, a longing for chaos comes in. And how I kind of get there also is around your description of Copernicus as having a desire to see the universe as an integrated whole. And so there's that account. And then there is this account of the changing standpoint. So we have all these changing standpoints of subjectivity. And so I'm thinking, as all of these changing standpoints are changing, then that, of course, the structure is dynamic, it's changing, but how might chaos be an element of that change in the structure, right? So you've got so many, think about like infinite number of changing standpoints that are constantly, right, Numbers are evolving, because I don't want to bring a teleological conception, but they're changing. So infinite changing standpoints. And then how can the universe hold together in a systematic, structural way? Or you can talk about all these different spheres, okay, the sphere of art, but we think about the universe as a whole, right? It seems to me that there's a place for chaos in this view that isn't really articulated in what I've been hearing. So I want to hear your thoughts on chaos and how you would understand what chaos is.
Yeah, I have to admit, I grew up in chaos. For me, this is not something that you seek, but you try to overcome. The way I see it is we're constantly trying to overcome the initial chaos of our lives, to find order in that, right? And that's what Copernicus does. That's what Kant does. Kant sometimes talks about the chaotic aggregate of sensation, which unfortunately people latch onto, and that has become almost hallmarks of both the theoretical and practical interpretations of Kant. Now, I see that as just the limit from which one starts, and you never completely overcome it, because you never can, as a human being, be completely accessible in eliciting order from chaos. But you have to constantly fight for it, also in human relations, right? And that's what Kant ethics and his political philosophy is about. Overcoming these chaotic and dangerous tendencies through using those very tendencies, like the tendency to war, to bring people together.
To me, that's one particular standpoint on chaos, right, that you're articulating, that we need to overcome it. But are there elements in the universe that have a different standpoint in relation to chaos that don't take that fundamental attitude of trying to overcome it?
The way that the Greeks understand chaos, for instance, is much more as that which is indeterminate. And so what I would say about that is we can never completely overcome that, and nor should we. In a way, my objection to, I guess it's an objection to analytic philosophy, is an objection that analytic philosophers don't take the notion of what is indeterminate seriously. For them, it's always some sort of aberration that you have to deal with, starting from structures that are already fully defined. And that's actually what I object to also in the conception of logic and mathematics that people take to be universally shared. So my view is that what made the mathematics of Brouwer and Weyl philosophically exciting was that they took the continuum to be something that's not decomposable into definite number structures, but that is prior to any attempt to articulate things into the number series. But that's, you know, just by the very nature of the case, a minority view, because this seems threatening to people, I think.
Courtney is an assistant professor, having done her PhD at Riverside, now at the United States Military Academy, about which I'm sure there's a lot to say. She has worked on Kant's theory of education, which must be very interesting in that context, and she's going to talk to us today on the analytic method, the synthetic method, and the idea of philosophy. Kant on how to read Kant.
This is a panel of structuralism after Kant, and you'll see that I don't say anything about structuralism after Kant. But I think there are quite a few things that I have to say about the structuralism that I find within Kant. And some of it will dovetail with Pierre's talk. If there's any indication from Kant himself about how to read Kant and about how to understand him in a systematic way for maximal understanding, I think we find it in his comments about how his critical works are connected with the notion of method. And here are some examples. He says that the prolegomena, which, quote, follows the analytic method, is the easier guide to the first critique, which follows the synthetic method. He says that the organization of the groundwork is most suitably laid out by beginning with the two analytic sections, followed by what we all know to be the more difficult third synthetic section. He says in the second critique that the reader should, quote, synthetically return to what has been given analytically in understanding his system. And there is a strange footnote in the first critique where he says that his experimental method shares similarities with the chemist's use of reduction, or what he calls there the synthetic procedure, and he contrasts that with the analysis that he's doing. And so it would seem that if we could get a grip on what Kant means by some of these distinctions, we could reveal something about how Kant wants us to read him. Unfortunately, and maybe not surprisingly, things quickly become murky. First, there's no obvious commonalities between the notions of method as he refers to them in these texts. He quite famously and explicitly states, both in the inquiry and in the first critique, that philosophy cannot proceed synthetically the way he takes math to proceed, and this complicates any claim that the first critique does indeed proceed synthetically. And it's unclear what the connection is between these so-called synthetic and analytic methods with other important methods that we associate with Kant, such as the so-called transcendental method, which the neo-Kantians make much of, and to the critical method, which is the method that he's constantly referring to in his critical works. It's also unclear what the connection is between these notions of method and the sections of his critical works where he directly discusses method, which is in the Method and Lehre, the Doctrine of Method, where we should learn something about these notions of method. So this paper was really born with an attempt to just take a look at these different distinctions to see where it led. And for me, where it led is the conclusion that we must make many distinctions, only implicit in his own discussions, among Kant's notions of method. And that once we do that, it actually reveals quite a bit about how Kant wants us to read him and how Kant himself conceptualizes his project. Indeed, I think it reveals that Kant himself places a high significance on the doctrine of method that we get in the three critiques and the Metaphysics of Morals, quite contrary to the general tendency of readers to dismiss that part of the critiques. And I also think it reveals what he took to be one of the most crucial upshots of his whole philosophical project, which is that it gives us a significant rethinking of the very activity of philosophy. And so I think that's the promise. Once we make the several distinctions that I offer on page 2 of your handout. And I hope this chart is not too confusing, but this is a visual representation of the different notions of these analytic and synthetic methods that I find in Kant's logic lectures. And I call these distinctions a family resemblance precisely because I find no single thread among the various uses of analytic and synthetic methods in Kant. And I should say, if you look at the history of these terms, there is also no single thread in the history. The distinction goes back to Aristotle, it runs through Euclid, it goes through early modern philosophy, and it is all over the map. But we can find some similarities here. So in the blue, I have listed the different ways in which Kant talks about the analytic method. And he usually uses the metaphor of down to up with analysis. So we get going from consequences to grounds. He uses that language in many different ways. Sometimes he talks about the consequences being conclusions. Sometimes he talks about the grounds being premises. And in other ways, we go from the effects to the causes. He talks about the analytic method from going to the low cognitions to the high cognitions, from the conditioned, confusedly he uses the word grounded here, to the principles, whole to part, things that rest on principles, to the principles, common concepts to the rules or principles. And oftentimes with the synthetic method, he reverses these, although he adds new ones in. So the synthetic method is sometimes referred to from going from grounds to conclusions, from high abstract cognitions to the low ones, from definitions, axioms, corollaries, consequences, from principles to the conditioned, from part to whole, from principles of reason to the things that rest on those principles, and from simple to composite. So by calling these family resemblances, again, I mean to say that sometimes when he refers to an analytic method, it gets picked up on one of these strands, but not the others, which is to say that sometimes a text or an argument can be analytic in one of these ways, but not analytic in the other, and that the same text or argument could be analytic in one way and synthetic in another way. I've noted when I've found some important commonalities with the way that these terms were used historically before Kant, and I'll just point out a couple of these. The second sense of the synthetic, from definitions to axioms, corollaries to consequences, this is what Kant calls the mathematical method, and indeed it's the method of synthesis that you find in geometry, most particularly in Euclid. If you look at Euclid's Elements, it's interesting that he calls it the Elements because we have the doctrine of elements in Kant. So if you look at the Euclidean Elements, it follows this procedure. Starts with definitions, goes to corollaries, and so on. And geometry does have a similar notion of analysis, right? And in geometrical proofs, you proceed by analysis when you take a conclusion that you think is true or that you think is given, and that you analyze it back to whatever has to be true in order for that conclusion to be true. So this is kind of the mathematical notions of synthesis and analysis that we get. And Kant certainly picks up on these, as we'll see in the Critique and the Prolegomena. And it's crucially important for Kant that in that notion of synthesis, it allows for a complete and thorough and systematic representation of whatever system that you're working with. So if you proceed synthetically, and if you start with the most basic definitions and you proceed from there, if you have a complete system, you can get the complete system. Importantly, in the analytic method, you cannot do that. If you start with a single conclusion and work your way back, you'll kind of get whatever must be true for that particular conclusion, but you'll get kind of a haphazard picture of the system, and you won't get a complete picture of the system. And I think this is a really important point for Kant. He has yet more additional uses of synthetic and analytic. In the inquiry, he says, arriving at a definition synthetically means to arbitrarily combine concepts. So we continually get this notion of synthesis is combining things, and the notion of analysis is breaking things apart and separating them out, which is how he describes arriving at definition analytically, which he thinks philosophy does better and mathematics proceeds better synthetically. There are yet more distinctions that I think we need to make in order to make sense of Kant's various comments here. And that's because the methods that I've described them is just describes the order in which the elements come. But a method is a method for a purpose. And I think there's at least four, perhaps five, but at least four purposes that we find across the methodologies. So you can use a method to prove a conclusion. You can use a method to present a subject matter. A method can be one that you follow where it describes how you should investigate a particular subject matter, or a method that you could follow whereby you should understand a subject matter. And both of those last two notions of method are normative notions, right? They're telling us how we should properly proceed. And I think Kant is most interested in these normative notions of method. However, I think when he talks about the methods popping up in his text, I think he's using the descriptive notions. Most often, the ways in which the texts are presented. And I think this is what he means by calling the critique of pure reason, when he says it follows the synthetic method, I take it to be a synthetic presentation. Here I say it's in the fourth and seventh sense, from going to the parts to the whole, or from the simple to the composite. And what I mean by that is he starts with the most basic elements of the faculties that he's working with, right? We start with space and time, pure forms of intuition. We move to the basic elements of the understanding, the categories. We then move to the combined notions, the judgments, right? And then to the ideas which are based on the relational categories. So we move to the more complex. And importantly for Kant, he thinks that he's offering a complete account of these along the way, right? So space and time are the two forms of intuition. The 12 categories is complete, according to Kant, right? Because it's based on what he takes to be the complete logical function of judgments. Because the principles are based on the categories, the principles are complete. And likewise, he thinks that there's three and only three ideas of transcendental ideas of pure reason. So in this sense, he can say that the synthetic presentation of the critique offers its reader a complete system, right? And the reader himself can be assured that it's complete. And I think that that is not true of the Prolegomena, which is an analytic presentation. And I take it to be analytic in the mathematical sense, where you start with conclusions and you work your way back to show what conditions must be true to get to those conclusions. And the way in which I would take the Prolegomena to be an analytic presentation is by its sections. If you look at the questions that Kant centers the Prolegomena around, you'll see that the first question is how is synthetic a priori knowledge in pure mathematics possible? We start with the conclusion that it's possible. We work our way back. Likewise with synthetic a priori knowledge in empirical science. Now we take the groundwork, the first two sections of the groundwork, to be analytic in a different sense. Insofar, I identify as the sixth sense here, going from common concepts to rules or principles, which is what the groundwork does, right? It begins with our common sense notion of duty, analyzes that up to the categorical imperative, and then in the third section we get a reversal of that. So let me just return to what I take to be the relationship between the first critique and the Prolegomena. Very importantly, I think, Kant says that the composition of the first critique is synthetic, and it was the system itself that compelled Kant to present it in that synthetic way, right? And in the Prolegomena, he says, oh, look, I had to do it analytically for the sake of the reader. But for the sake of the system, he had to lay it out synthetically. And I think this is an interesting comment. What I'd now like to suggest is that the Prolegomena, though an analytically presented text, is actually a type of synthesis of the first critique. And I use this language only because Kant uses this language. Again, confusing these terms, perhaps. In the second critique, he has this wonderful passage, I've given it to you, but he's talking about how the reader should understand him. And he says, look, you have to understand the parts first, all right? That's a necessary piece of it. And you can only understand the parts by working your way through the text. But then you need to get to a second stage. And he says, this is the overview, the synthetic return to what has previously been given only analytically. If you do not take this second step, he says, it is no wonder that you might find inconsistencies everywhere, although the gaps you suppose to find in the system itself is only part of your incoherent train of thought. So here I think he's referring to perhaps the lack of synthetic return that he found in his own readers. I think he offered the Prolegomena after the critique as a way of showing his readers, here's the work that you should have done after the critique that you didn't do, right? And it was clear, became clear to Kant that his readers didn't do this type of synthetic return in the reviews of the critique, where it was clear to Kant that readers were just not getting it. I think he thought the reader would do more work, especially at the end of the Doctrine of Elements of the first half of the critique. So in this sense, a synthetic return represents a synthesis in what I've called the first sense. The grounds and the high cognitions in this case is the idea of the whole. So he says, look, in order to synthetically return to something, in order to understand it, you need a grasp of the whole, which can only be understood first by the parts. And then you need to have an understanding of that, how that whole grounds both the content and arrangement of the parts. So this is my nod to structuralism here. The idea of the whole has a structure that only gets articulated through the very process of delineating it and understanding it. And this is a passage I love, and it mirrors many passages at the end of the critique. It is too bad that it is first possible for us to glimpse the idea in a clearer light and to outline a whole architectonically in accordance with the ends of reason, only after we have long collected the relevant cognitions haphazardly, like building materials, and worked through them technically, with only a hint of the idea hidden within us. So I take it that the relationship to the prolegomena to verse critique is this type of synthetic return, where the idea of the whole that Kant is referring to is what I take to be just the system of possible synthetic a priori truths that we're going through in the critique. What I'd like to suggest further is that the prolegomena does not represent the proper synthetic return to the first half of the critique. Indeed, I think the proper synthetic return is found in the Doctrine of Method, which is properly the second half of the critique, and the second half that often gets ignored. There, I'd like to suggest that we synthetically return to the elements, the Doctrine of Elements in the critique, with a view to their relationship to the idea of the whole, where in this case, the idea of the whole is the idea of philosophy as an activity. I would say the idea of philosophy is a discipline, but Kant uses that word in a different way. The method in Lehrer presents a method of how we should proceed with the investigation of philosophical truth, given the findings of its first half. And again, it's through the very activity of critiquing reason and the activity of understanding that critique, that the structure of this new idea emerges. And it's only through that activity that the new idea can emerge. Simultaneously, it's only through the activity of critique, and again, understanding that critique, that the old structure collapses in on itself, or that you can see the old structure, the old idea of philosophy collapsing in on itself. And it is here that Kant reiterates his point that philosophy cannot proceed synthetically. And he's clearly referring to here to the method of investigation in the second sense of method, by starting with definitions, going to axioms, corollaries, consequences. Think of Spinoza's ethics here. So what are these old and new ideas? I take the old idea of philosophy that is crumbling under the recognition of the idea of the whole here to be the scholastic idea, and this is Kant's language. And by scholastic idea, he doesn't mean to narrowly refer to the historical group. Indeed, Pierre's talk, I think, shows nicely that probably the scholastic, the model for the scholastic idea is Ptolemy. And the model for the new idea of philosophy, which is the cosmopolitan idea, is something like the continental reading of Copernicus, but we can talk more about that. Now, under the scholastic idea of philosophy, the idea was that the elements could somehow, through and after investigation, reach a kind of final and static formulation that could then be presented in complete logical and systematic unity. And then to philosophize under that system would simply be to learn that system, right? Go to the book, learn it, and now you're a philosopher. Kant is very clear
that is not what it means to philosophize. Under the proper idea of philosophy, which again has emerged from the critique itself, is, quote, the science of the relation of all cognition to the essential ends of reason. And a philosopher is someone who legislates that human reason. Now, I'm hopefully short on time here, where I don't have to provide an argument for my view of the essential ends of reason, because I think it's a tricky question for Kant, or a tricky question for Kantian interpreters. But I take the essential ends of reason to be those things that are captured by the three questions that we get in the canon. What can we know? What should we do? What may we hope for? Indeed, I take it that the essential ends of reason are essentially wanting clear, definite answers to our metaphysical questions, our ethical questions, and our religious questions. And on my view, philosophizing under this idea, under this new idea of philosophy, is what it means to follow, quote, the critical method of Kant's. Oftentimes, I think a lot of interpretations of Kant say, well, Kant's critical method is what he enacts in his critiques. And I take it that the critical method is actually what he is saying that we should do after the findings of the critique. Then there's the outstanding question of what Kant's method is, or method of proof is, for his transcendental idealism, if it's not the so-called critical method that I'm rejecting. He's clear here that it's the experimental method, again, which shares another connection to the notions of synthetic and analytic method. Brigitte Falkenberg, I think, she argues that the experimental method of the critique, where we form a hypothesis, the hypothesis of transcendental idealism, and then we kind of test it out, right, to see what happens. She argues that this is analogous to the combined analytic synthetic method of Newton. The combined analytic synthetic method of Newton was Newton, and Pierre might add to this here, analysis for Newton was looking at the effects, right, and looking and experimenting, and then going back to see what are the principles that are grounding the experiments and the effects back to its causes, right? And then he thought we needed to reverse it and say, okay, now we'll synthesize back, we'll formulate principles based on that analysis, and then we'll offer a synthesis. So it's a combined method. It's not an opposed method. Now, I think Pierre's paper has made me rethink this a little bit, and maybe this is too narrow of a reading of Kant's method of proof. But it is only by making this large array of distinctions among methods that I think that we can properly kind of understand this upshot of Kantian project. So thank you.
In your chart, you said they all have a family resemblance. I was wondering what you make of the correlation between analyticity and necessity, and synthetic and contingent. Mm-hmm. I haven't had a good look to analyze it, but what do you think about that relationship?
Yeah, good. Yeah, I agree with you about the literature. I think Geyer and Wood, in their introduction, are rather dismissive of Kant's comment here. And I think Geyer argues that, well, Kant just follows the analytic method. And by that, I think he's kind of referring to this transcendental argument that we get in the transcendental deduction. He does it in both the critique and the prolegomena. It's just analyzing different things. So at least Geyer is rather dismissive of the comment. So thank you for your question in regards to the notion of necessity. And here's where we might get some connections between these notions of methods and the all-important analytic synthetic distinction as far as statements are concerned, right? So we get these two different notions of necessity in analytic and synthetic statements. And I think it's an interesting question to ask You know, when you have an analytic statement, Kant sometimes talks about that as the predicate is kind of just unpacking already what's logically necessary in the subject, right? And then with a synthetic statement, the predicate is kind of supplementing in some way the subject. And I think it's an interesting question to ask whether those notions of necessity follow these notions of method. So in other words, the question would be, when we are engaged in the analytic method, are we merely kind of unpacking what we already took to be as part of our subject matter, which might be something close to what we do when we analyze things, right? Let's take this concept and we unpack it and we see, like, what are we committed to already, right? As opposed to kind of throwing things to new things together, which we associate with this method of synthesis. I don't want to say that Kant always thinks that the method of analysis is unpacking what's already necessarily in there, because I don't think that's true all of the time. But one text where I think he does talk that way is in the Paralogisms. There he says that the rationalists, in thinking that they were coming up with synthetic a priori knowledge about the soul, were actually only using the analytic method. And by that, I think he means, like, the conclusions that the rationalists are finding about the soul are there only because they're logically packed into the way that they've set the argument up. And once we recognize that, we can see that there is no such synthetic argument in the way that they think. So I think that Kant sometimes does connect these notions to the same types of necessity. I don't think he does that all the time. Like, I'm not sure, you know, when he says in the Groundwork that we start with this common sense notion of duty, I don't know if he means that the categorical imperative is already logically contained in that notion, right? Or if he means simply that let's figure out our other commitments if we're committed to this notion of duty.
One thing I wanted to ask you about is the passage from the Prolegomena on page 3 of your handout, towards the end there, when he's, you know, sort of saying, look, if you're not willing to carry out the synthetic return, then no wonder if you find inconsistencies. Although the gaps, I don't know what that is in the German, although the gaps they suppose they find are not in the system itself. It sounds like what Kant is saying is he's saying there's some kind of a relation between the appearance of inconsistency and the appearance of incompleteness. And somehow if you can show that the system is complete and doesn't have gaps, that will make inconsistencies go away. I wonder if you could try and help me. I might just be misreading that. But we think of completeness and consistency as two different things, right? But it almost sounds like he's conflating them here in a certain way.
The way that I read this passage is similar to something that Pierre was talking about, where you get these readers of the critique, right? And they focus in on, like, what's the argument of the transcendental deduction? Then they say, like, there's much ado about it, right? Not that I find that to be completely not worthwhile, but I think Kant's saying, like, well, look, if you understand the relationship of that to, if you understand kind of the whole project, right, then you can go back to these parts and see them in a different light, which is really difficult to do because it's difficult enough with the first critique in particular just to understand the parts, right? And I think it's this grappling with trying to understand the parts where people just get kind of hung up on it. And so they say, well, Kant's trying to give us this theory of objective judgment, and it doesn't work for these reasons, but they're just not seeing the big picture in the way that he wants them to, in a way that is very difficult to do. So with the inconsistencies and completeness, Yeah, I guess I haven't thought about that. There's definitely something there that I feel like Kant is saying, no, it's the understanding of the completeness that is going to elide those seemingly inconsistencies that you find. So not that they're the same thing necessarily, but there is an important connection interpretively between understanding the complete system and kind of giving new significance to the parts, or giving the proper significance to the parts in a way that some inconsistencies would appear to go away, or go away, the appearance of inconsistencies.
Yeah, thanks. That's really super helpful. And so, I mean, I see how it fits in with what Pierre was talking about before in terms of the monster made of the different parts. And so it almost seems like if we, you know, bring in kind of the third critique perspective on living organisms, that part of the problem is going to be, if you try and explain what a hand is, say, by itself, in some sense, because you're treating it as a thing, it's going to be a kind of inconsistent machine, so to speak, in some way.
That's great. Yeah.
So if I could just ask one other related question about these, you know, these tensions between different senses of the terms that you really juggle so well. So on the last page of your handout, when you're talking about the scholastic idea being associated with a certain kind of synthetic method. And then I was just wondering about what you were saying about the paralogisms and how, like, both with rational cosmology, at least with, I haven't thought about rational cosmology, but with rational psychology and rational theology, in both cases, there's a clear kind of packing in, as you were saying, into the concept, what you claim to be deriving. So what's the relation between that procedure in rational psychology and theology on the one hand, and then what's being said about the scholastic approach here?
The synthetic method as a method of investigation is going to proceed as if the parts had significance in and of themselves, right? Which is kind of this transcendental illusion of like, well, let's look at the thing in itself and let's proceed this way of just figuring out what this leads to, right? So if there's an error in the kind of scholastic procedure, I think it's that error of thinking that you can just take these as unconnected to the interests of reasoners, right? And unconnected to the essential ends of reason, which is how Kant characterizes the cosmopolitan idea of philosophy, right? So if you forget that, and you take them to be things in themselves, and you take it that you can proceed that way, then you're going to kind of buy into the transcendental illusion we find in both the psychology and the theology and the cosmos, right? It's just that in the cosmos, he kind of shows that it's not just the rationalists who are guilty of this. Right, the empiricists do it too. so it's,
There seems to be an absence of an account of ordinary experience. And so it seems to me that we have to have an account of ordinary experience in order to then sort of confirm the results of the product that is the first critique. And so I wonder if you could sort of, and that's a problem of method. Right.
Yeah.
So I wonder if you could sort of speak to that. I mean, is that in your mind a legitimate concern, or do you have a way of responding to say that no, Kant actually does sort of give us a way of demonstrating how the project gets off the ground?
I take it that there's kind of two important parts of your question, and the first is this question of how he gets his system off the ground. And I think there's all kinds of interpretations out there that make it look like Kant is either begging the question against Hume, if you take the prolegomena to present arguments, right? Or if you take the critique as a synthetic argument, then it looks like he has to start with these definitions that you take to be given and true, and then it seems like, well, how can he presume these things, right? I take it that if we kind of understand what he's doing under the experimental method, then we get much closer to how we get the transcendental idealism off the ground. And I take it that his method of discovery was something like, okay, he looks at the method that works in science, whereby we make progress in science, right? Which is this, what I was taking to be this kind of experimental method of Newton, what Newton calls the analytic part of his method. We experiment and we see what happens on certain hypotheses, right? So on the Kant's experimental method, I think he said, I think he recognizes, look, these assumptions of transcendental realism, they're not getting us anywhere. So let's experiment, right? Let's see what happens if we presume that there's a distinction between the thing in itself and the appearance. And let's see if it comes together in a harmonious system, right? I think that's what's important for Kant, is like the type of harmony that we get on his system with all these disparate elements. I think the fact that we can get harmony is important for him. And then your question also had to do with the importance of ordinary experience. Is that how you put it? And I think, again, that's going to be kind of confirmation for Kant, because I think he's going to, I think he wants to show us in the critique that his system can accommodate the types of commitments we do have in ordinary experience, right? It can accommodate our desire for theoretical knowledge if we bring in the practical. It can accommodate the types of what he calls interests that we have as reasoners in a way that the scholastic conception or transcendental realism can't, right? So he's partly trying to show us, look, on these old conceptions of philosophy, your ordinary experience and the commitments that you have in that ordinary experience are only going to get frustrated, right? It's the type of frustration that pops up in the antinomy. You're not going to be able to answer your question satisfactorily. You're going to be led to skepticism or cynicism. And I take it that the fact that he doesn't think his system does that, and rather supports our interests as reasoners as a whole, all of them, I think that is an important connection to this sense of kind of our ordinary experience, or at least the interests that we have being creatures that can reason.
So you want to emphasize some kind of open-endedness to the project, I think, at the end of your paper, and talking about the activity of a critique as sort of not ever quite completed.
Yeah.
And yet, it does seem to me that Kant thinks he's established pretty definite answers to the questions, what can we know, what should we do, and what may we hope for. How do these two thoughts fit together for you?
Yeah, good question, because I think that you're right that on the one hand I'm saying, look, Kant thinks the system is complete. He thinks the reader of the critique can be assured that this is a complete analysis of all the possible theoretical synthetic a priori truths. So in that sense, I do take it to be complete, and I think that it's important for Kant that it's complete. But I take it that in the methodology where he's talking about this new conception of philosophy and what it is that the ideal philosopher will do, and for Kant it's just an ideal, as the legislator of human reason, I take it that this is a question of each autonomous person grappling with philosophical questions his or herself within their society, where new philosophical questions will automatically arise, right? And so we constantly have this barrage of individual and societal philosophical questions that we have to, each individual in each society has to grapple with. And I take it that Kant's advice to us is not to, he certainly wants us to read the critique as part of our grappling. But he doesn't want us to say, well, the critique says this, so this is the answer, right? He wants us to read the critique and then see kind of how he's shown us how the the real conception of philosophy is that we have to recognize how our philosophical grapplings are kind of connected with our essential ends as reasoners, right? So it is this kind of, here's how to proceed with both the individual and the societal philosophical questions that will constantly upend both the individual's life and the society.
Hmm. I think there's a real puzzle here, so I think you're on to something. I wonder whether it can be just a matter of new questions popping up. So there's the famous passage where he says, philosophy as the completed archetype, as the ectype, never exists. We can only learn how to philosophize by practicing on previously existing attempts at philosophy. That's an image of never quite finishing, never quite getting there with the answers to the very same questions. And yet there is this emphasis on definite answers, completeness, and systematicity too. So I guess I'm not clear that the way you put it captures that first thought. And I don't know how to do it either.
I have to think about that.
Kant actually, in the preface to the Metaphysics of Morals, says that every philosopher has to, in a certain sense, begin from scratch, because they're all concerned with thinking through to the one truth, as if there hadn't been any philosophy before that. And he mentions then an analogy to contemporary chemistry, the chemistry of Lavoisier. In the Critique, he had held up the chemistry of phlogiston chemistry as science that was worth emulating. My point is that Kant has the ambition of turning metaphysics into a science and developing it systematically from his standpoint in history and in thought, and he thinks it's normative in that sense. But there's no sense, and I don't think this is a sense in Hegel either, or anybody, which, despite the fact that every leading scholar believes it to be so without any compelling evidence, I think. So I don't think any of the German idealists, beginning with Kant, think that they have reached the final position in philosophy, so that, as Eckhart Furster puts it, there's only 20 years of philosophy. I mean, the whole idea is it just a complete misinterpretation of what they're thinking. They're thinking, look, from our standpoint, we have to endeavor to provide the systematic articulation of things. And Kant says, look, from my standpoint, I take that to be complete and non-revisable. But that doesn't mean that another philosopher cannot come along and offer his. He just had mild worries about people doing that even before he was in the grave, right? So he was open to that, but there were people like Maimon running around already revising everything. So point being that when it comes down to it, there's a general temptation to think of a priori principles, as Kant sees them, as these abstract, timeless structures, and then there's a deep mystery as to how we grasp them or how he does. But I think the actually more accurate interpretation is that Kant thinks that we uncover these principles by endeavoring to systematize and make our ability to engage with the world differentially and systematically coherent. And that then gives us the basis for thinking that these are timeless, but without it actually ever being the case that they can be so. So that's the parallax view, actually.
The way that I think about this is in terms of what I think is a kind of meta-antinomy that Kant sort of inadvertently opened up without really recognizing, in a way. Because if you think of antinomies as problems that can be logically resolved in a definitive way, then I think you end up with something more like Kant claiming to have finished certain things, And I think that that's really supported by a lot of the metaphors he uses, like, for instance, in the preface to the first edition of the Critique, where it's all about, you know, we were basically didn't have even have civil society. We had civil war in philosophy, but the tribunal is going to establish, you know, philosophy as a kind of state, really, in which, indeed, other issues can be juridically revolved. And then there's that late essay on the imminent conclusion of a treaty of perpetual peace in philosophy, you know, where he really does seem to be claiming that, yeah, I did finish certain things. But the other way of thinking about antinomies is that they're sort of like aporias that we keep coming up against. You know, and then in that sense, we get the other kind of view. And that's how I think of the origin of the analytic continental divide, is coming out of sort of two different ways of thinking about how you respond to antinomies. Do you think of them as logical disputes, or do we think of them as something like aporias that we can only respond to by purporting subjective universality for a view on them, you know, so that when Kant distinguishes between, disputing and arguing, as came up yesterday, those are two different models of philosophical argumentation. Is philosophy a matter of logically disputing, or is it a matter of arguing? And I share Richard's sense that Kant never really settled that one, and there are things he says that make him sound like a logical disputer, even though he does open up that other possibility as well.
In connection to those comments, it struck me that transcendental illusion is also a stubborn fact, right? And if it's the goal of the philosopher to legislate human reason, then it's part of the philosopher's job to kind of guard against us continually being deluded by transcendental illusion, right? And the philosopher can do that by reminding us of the limits. So that's one piece of it, I think. Yeah, so thank you.
Thank you all. Congratulations to Pierre and to Helmut for the program, to all our speakers, the audience. Thank you.
Yeah.